pleasure to introduce Kevin Omland. He graduated from Dartmouth College and did his PhD at SUNY Albany. He followed that with a few postdocs at Duke University, University of Minnesota, and Smithsonian Conservation Biology Institute, and joined the ranks of the faculty at UMBC down the road in 2000, where he has been a full professor now since 2012. Kevin, in 2004, received one of the very prestigious NSF Career Awards, despite sort of the usual teaching and mentoring loads that go with being a faculty member at the leading undergraduate institution, he has managed to get well over 80 publications, and back in 2016, last year, he was named the UMBC Presidential Research Professor. His work focuses on the phylogeny, evolution, behavior, and conservation of songbirds, in particular orioles, which is very significant for where we are. I have always been really impressed by Kevin's thinking. The way he thinks about phylogenies is very insightful about how we depict these phylogenies and how we interpret what we're depicting. And we've had several examples recently where that interpretation was less than stellar. We have had Kevin help us teach. Here he teaches our lecture on phylogenetics for our genomics and bioinformatics course, and I thought together with Michelle that we would also invite him to come and give a seminar. We've tried that for several years, and finally this year it worked out. So I'm really happy to have him here, and let's see what we have to say.
Great, thanks for that nice introduction, Joanna. Let's see, I did not try the volume. Seems sounds very loud to me, perhaps. We'll work on that. It's hard for me to speak quietly. That does not come naturally to a teacher, right? So it's great to be here. I do spend a lot of my time thinking about the evolution of bird coloration. I do also happen to work on ravens and orioles, both of which were established before I ever considered applying to a school in Baltimore. So it's a fun coincidence. So I'd be happy to chat with people individually about that. But this has always been sort of a side interest throughout my career. And when I started teaching intro bio and trying to teach tree thinking, it became more and more prominent. And then colleagues of mine, Mike Crisp and Lynn Cook at Australian National University, came out with a great article in 2005, and I said I want to go work with those people and continue to chip away at that problem. So I'll be talking about that work. As we know, phylogenies can play crucial roles in all of biology, and the increasing importance of phylogenetics and its central importance in in evolutionary biology and biology as a whole today, I think we can attribute to a lot of the work that people here do on DNA sequencing and genomics due to better algorithms, fast computational work. But our conceptual advances in tree thinking in the last 20, 30, 50 years are absolutely central to where phylogenies are today. So for those of you who don't think about phylogenies every day, a phylogeny or a phylogenetic tree, to be more precise, you know, it's just simply an evolutionary tree showing relationships among organisms or among genes. And we frequently tend to focus on the topology, the branching pattern of the tree. So we use words, lots of botanical words, like the root, an ancestral node, a branch, a leaf. Phylogenetics tends not to use that word, but I think computational or computer scientists do. And it's absolutely crucial, there's a different way of presenting it, but the absolute crucial, most crucial point is that the root of a tree gives us the sense of where time is in the past. And all of these are extant species or genes. Some of us might work on, if we're working on DNA, the oldest DNA we're ever going to work on, at least in our lifetimes, are going to be 300,000, 500,000 years, maybe 1 million years. So 99% of this is really focused on a focus on the present. And so having that time axis oriented properly, in this case from left to right, and that an absolutely crucial point is that this axis on this tree absolutely means nothing. So lots and lots of people, you know, there's definitely YouTube videos that say this axis is time and this axis is relatedness. And that is not true, at least in a simple, strict way. So here's this orientation with the root being at the bottom, the present being up here. And so there's all of these terms, but what plant part is missing? And what's, we don't have flowers, but what plant part is missing from this tree? What's a term that you know, that botanists would use all the time, or a forester would use all the time? What's missing? There's no trunk, right? There is no stem. So there's no trunk and there's no stem ever in a phylogeny in 2017. So if you think you're seeing a stem or a trunk, your eyes are being tricked. So here's what, this was the first phylogeny, or the first use of the term phylogeny by Ernst Haeckel in 1866. And this is very much based on the idea of a scala naturae, right? That bacteria are at the bottom, humans are quite near the top, and then above them come angels and gods at the very top. So that ladder of progress thinking was very prominent in early biology, early evolutionary biology. But a trunk is completely missing from our trees today. So there's no main branch ever. And that's absolutely crucial to understanding that there's no goal to evolution. And to me, you know, certainly teaching intro bio, that's absolutely important to understanding the most fundamental process of evolution, that evolution is not goal-oriented. So these issues continue to raise their head. So this was a flyer that came in the mail from Sinauer to me in May 2007 or 2014. And there was, so here's this this tree of Haeckel that has Monera amoeba. So these are sort of extant species in the trunk. Primitive worms in the trunk. Semi-apes, like lemurs, are in the trunk with man, or as Haeckel would have write, mention, up at the very top. And then things like soft animals lower down, amphibians lower down, with birds of prey or hoofed animals near the top. So there's a couple things about this tree that are fundamentally misleading. One is extant species ancestral to other extant species, and the other is the idea of some species being lower animals, lower plants, higher animals, higher plants. So here comes this this tree of life. So this is Sinauer, a very respected publisher, has published a lot in this realm, publishing a paper on the tree of life, and it's a very Haeckel-like tree. It's got bacteria and amoeba, extant species in the trunk, and certainly this lower higher thing. So I emailed or called Sinauer and said, you know, you can't, this is really against what we're trying to do. It really, really portrays a misleading conception of evolution. And so we were able to stop the cover before it was printed. So when the book came out 2 months later, so at least we got rid of some of the worst offense in that tree thinking. But sort of how people think about trees, how trees are depicted, is really crucial to how we understand phylogenies, how we understand the very process of evolution. And so when we're trying to use phylogenies, whether it's in my case to understand, you know, how long orioles have been out in the Caribbean, or in the case of some of you trying to figure out one, you know, what's the ancestral state of some disease gene, thinking clearly about the trees is absolutely crucial. So here was the last time everyone attempted to have a paper tree of life published, right? So back in 2003, there were few enough genomes and we knew little enough about the whole tree of life that you might actually pretend to print it in an article. So this was in 2003. But there's no trunk in this tree. There's no part of this tree which is thicker. There's no trunk implied. And so it's really much less like a tree than a hedge. You know, that all of these extant species have all made it to 2003, or now 2017. And so it's really important to realize that this lineage leading to humans is no longer than this lineage leading to a bacteria or a archaea. And the fact that humans are on the far right there is simply where the editors decided to put them. That location left to right means nothing. But these sort of Haeckel-like scala natura depictions of evolution continue to be very prominent. So this was on Darwin's birthday a couple years ago. A friend of mine posted this. And so here's someone celebrating Darwin, very much sort of trying to, you know, very interested in what Darwin has told us about the planet. But this little human head is just a little bit higher than even the birds. And of course, Monera and, you know, prokaryotes very low on the tree, you know, fungi sort of medium in the tree. We're getting closer. We got up to lemurs. So clearly, there's the idea of lower and higher is really present in this tree. So here's a tree that's much more, not nearly as biased. There's no higher lower on this. There's very much, you know, like the hedge idea, all of these extant species have made it to the present. But there are animalia way off on the right. So that position is really emphasizing us and who we are. There's this great tool called OneZoom, which gives a wonderful unbiased view of the tree of life. So if you ask for where humans are, it just zooms in on this very, very amorphous, tiny little twig at some very random spot on the tree of life, no special position at all. And to me, that's absolutely central to understanding the process of evolution, and frankly, absolutely central to helping us understand our place on the planet and how we keep this planet in our existence. For the next few hundred years at least, if not longer. So I'll start by talking about a couple problems. One is the problem of tree focus. Which species you include in your tree, which genes you include in your gene tree study really affects how that tree looks and how you or others using your tree may interpret it. And the idea of not knowing how rotating branches can really affect the way you think about the tree. So those are sort of two problems. Then I'll focus on a couple of solutions, really looking for patterns of nesting and really using explicit ancestral state reconstruction. So in this, I teach a lot using the family ABCDidae, right? It's just a random group of arbitrary, non-real taxa. So when you look at this tree and you say, okay, which of these is A, B, C, or D older? Which of these is the most advanced species? And the very clear answer is that you can't tell. There's nothing, there's no information provided here about the age of the species. So one's eye is tempted to think, ah, that species has been around for a long time. Or this species looks like it's undergone, at least one of these two may have undergone more evolution and it might be more advanced, but no information is provided. And so what if this species, D is E. coli? What if species C is Vibrio? What if species B is Rickettsia, the species that causes Rocky Mountain spotted fever? And any guesses who I'm going to put in A? Sort of to be annoying to emphasize my point. And I want to play the game.
Human.
Yeah, I'm going to put humans there. So this is a quite annoying, but it really helps make the point that that humans don't have a special place in the tree of life. This is a very good representation of the relationships among these species, and people are really surprised to see humans in that spot. So what does this tree tell us? This tree only tells us two things. You know, there literally are just two pieces of information in this tree. So people see a tree like this, and they, you know, they might think they can say three or five or eight or even 15 things about it, but there's only two pieces of information in this tree. One is that species D, C, and D are each other's closest relatives. They share a more recent common ancestor with each other, than either does with the other two species, and that these three bacteria share a more recent common ancestor with each other than they do with humans. So anything else you think you see in that tree is misleading. You're being misled, you're being dragged down a road that you shouldn't be dragged down. So, almost every time I give this talk, people are bothered by this tree. And so there is something wrong with this tree. What's wrong with this tree? Have I done something, some sleight of hand, to make this very strange looking, arguing that this very strange looking tree is okay? There is something wrong with this tree. It is misleading in one very clear way. Branch lengths, he thinks, are misleading. Who said that? Thanks. So give me a second. There's nothing wrong with the branch lengths, okay? It is a cladogram, okay? So the branch lengths are unscaled. But give me a second and I'll surprise you. That's not what I'm getting at here. Anyone think of something else wrong with this tree? Yeah?
Humans and bacteria share a common ancestor at some point.
Sure, but this is LUCA, right? So that's fine. So the idea I'm fishing for, and sorry to play this game hard with you, is that this tree is incomplete. So we've left out a bunch of species.
There should be one more arm diverging from the root.
That arm would be?
The one starting at the root. Here.
That there would be something from here? Okay. Well, maybe this root should be shorter, but
okay.
Come talk to me afterwards. I learned something. I learn something every single time I give this talk that makes the next talk better and clarifies my thinking. But the point I was going for is that the taxon sampling is incomplete. So we're used to seeing much more taxon sampling on this side and, archaea or bacteria just sort of off to the left with small sampling. So would there be a better, if you're trying to root a tree of bacteria, is there a better species? Could we have used something else? So basically, we're using humans as the outgroup. Is there something else that would work better? Seems like, outgroups are sort of supposed to be primitive, right? Supposed to be simple or something in some way. There's really no better single species. You'd be foolhardy to try to just use one species to root that tree. But if you were to use one species, humans are just as good as any other member of archaea or eukarya. So these same points go for a gene tree. So this gene tree simply tells us two things. It says that hemoglobin A and B are each other's closest relatives compared to these species, and the myoglobin is more closely related to these two than either is to lampreyglobin. It doesn't tell us that lampreyglobin is older, doesn't say lampreyglobin is more primitive, it doesn't say it's simpler, doesn't say it's ancestral. It'd be very tempting and useful, in fact, to know that lampreyglobin was ancestral. But we don't know that, and we can't use this tree to say that. So gene trees, the same, whether you're building a species tree or a gene tree, the same conceptual issues apply. So here's an analogy, present day generation of my family based on Y chromosome. So either you could think of it as a phylogeny of individuals or even just a phylogeny of Y chromosomes. And so it shows that my brother and I share a more recent common ancestor than either of us do with these others. We don't have any first cousin on that side of the family, so we can't use a Y chromosome. But we have a second cousin in Norway. He uses molecular tools to study bird behavioral ecology. So there's a dominant gene that was present in our great-grandfather back here, because we were both pursuing this career for years without knowing each other was doing the same thing. And now we've done a lot together more recently. So anyway, we can't tell whether Trond is older or younger than I am. We can't tell if my brother Christian is older or younger than I am. We can't tell that he has way more math ability than I do. none of that's apparent from the tree. It does tell us about relationships. Only those two pieces of information about relationships. So phylogenies of extant taxa tell us about sibling and cousin relationships. So the chimps, rhesus monkeys are our cousins, you know. So the common misconception that chimps are ancestral to humans, teaching about trees in this way to me is one of the best ways of illustrating that all of these other organisms on the planet are our cousins. So it is crucial that each branch does not represent an extant individual species or gene. So if you're thinking that this whole branch represents the second cousin, or that this whole branch represents John F. Kennedy Jr., you're being misled. So by making this tree focused on Robert F. Kennedy, the son of the former Attorney General of the United States, we've really affected the way things look. So where is JFK the president? You know, he's just somewhere not represented really on this branch. So somewhere along this branch is this president. So there's tons and tons of nodes and information missing. This is really focusing on what's the relationship among these extant entities. So again, what is wrong with this cladogram? Are the branch lengths completely misleading? Is that why this tree looks so annoying to so many people? Have I really pulled the wool over your eyes by showing a cladogram that in some way tricks you? So if I convert this into a chronogram and so that it's scaled to time, again, it's incomplete. The chronogram looks very similar. So this is very rough, and some people in this room probably know this information way better than I do, but they're roughly E. coli and Vibrio share a common ancestor about 1 million years ago, Rickettsia about 2 billion years ago, and the Eukarya with the bacteria about 3 billion years ago. It might be 2.5, it might be 1.7, but basically, even though I was showing you a cladogram, and lots of people said you were misled, so I changed the species recently to make it so the chronogram looks a lot like the cladogram. So that's not so misleading. The misleading thing, or the thing that really bothers you, is the incomplete taxon sampling, but that every tree always has incomplete taxon sampling. So phylogenies can't tell us which species are older or younger, which species are primitive versus advanced, which species are ancestral versus derived, and which species are simple and complex. And in fact, so none of these are testable hypotheses using a phylogenetic tree. So again, it would be darn useful to be able to use trees to say this. It would be very interesting. This is when there's a new phylogeny produced. The New York Science Times wants for sure to say how ancient the species is. It's one of the favorite things for science journalists to say about taxa and phylogenies. But we really can't say us. The trees tell us nothing about this. And I would argue that these are, for the most part, non-testable hypotheses. No one publishes a paper that says this species, we have data that show this species is more simple than this species. So what can phylogenies be used for? They can be used to infer which characteristics are older or younger, which character states. Does having elaborate female plumage, is that the ancestral state or the derived state? Does having a serine versus a proline at this spot in a protein, which is the ancestral state? So it can tell us which characteristics are ancestral versus derived. So a very smart colleague of mine that teaches next to me, she still likes to use the term primitive and advanced, and I just think those are way too loaded. All we're talking about is whether a state is ancestral, older versus derived, more recently evolved. So we need to use methods of ancestral state that are analyzing one character at a time. So we're not saying lampreys are a primitive species. Let's say the skeletal structures or the absence of limbs, that's an ancestral characteristic of lampreys, but that the species is not ancestral or simple. And so when my colleagues in Australia came out with this paper in 2005 and I had a sabbatical coming up, I said, I'd really like to go work with you and write a paper that I knew in my department at UMBC, lots of people were using trees and tripping over them, and really having pieces of their research program being misled. And as I go around to other places, I'd see the same thing. And so our goal in this paper was to really expand. They had previously published a journal, an article in the journal Tree, Trends in Ecology and Evolution. But a lot of this tree thinking was being applied and tripping up people in cell biology and ecology and animal behavior and neurobiology. So our paper was aimed at thinking about gene trees and really making the message to a broader audience. So in their Trends in Ecology and Evolution paper, the title was, Do quote-unquote early branching lineages signify ancestral traits? So more and more I'm convinced that that also can be misleading. But they say no, that a species that's over there on the left of a tree does not necessarily have ancestral traits. And in fact, the thing you're studying, you know, that gene pathway you're studying, that neuron issue you're studying, the species on the left might very well have the derived state. So whereas character states can be relatively ancestral, these concepts are nonsensical when applied to whole organisms. So thinking of species as ancestral or derived is a big issue. Now, even card-carrying systematists of very strong national reputation do use these terms. You know, there's a recent fish recently described, and it was described with the species name Derrativum, that it's up in the sort of the upper right part of a tree. So these are very subtle issues. There's 3 or 5 or 8 of us that have been publishing about this. People get very annoyed by what we're saying some of the time. They'll send us emails. But no one has published responses that say our thinking is misleading. That doesn't mean we can't learn things and there's not problems with it. But this is there's a bunch of us that are really making strongly these arguments. So if you Google platypus primitive, you get 90,000 hits. That was several years ago. You probably get 500,000 hits by now. And you'll find things like these are the most primitive of living mammals. So the ductile platypus, my colleagues in Australia, several different groups in Australia started realizing these problems long before people in Europe and North America. And I think they sort of thought, wait a minute, why are they calling our mammals primitive? Why is my tree old? You know, there's nothing old or primitive about the species that's swimming in my backyard. So why do we think of platypus as a primitive species? And I think there are 2 reasons. One's their egg laying. So that's very reptile-like. That's an aspect of platypus that's retained, where they retain the ancestral state. And you know, reproduction is so central to organisms. Maybe it's so central to the human condition, the giving birth, that you really focus on this, the fact that they reproduce in quite different ways. But a huge thing is that they're from a species poor lineage. You know, they only have 2 close extant relatives, the two or three, depending upon how many species of echidna you think they are. So the fact that they're off by themselves with very few close relatives really makes them seem primitive to us. And I think we really get tricked into thinking that these species poor lineages are primitive or older in some way. So those are, you know, this egg laying is a retained ancestral trait. So that's sort of retained ancestral, that's sort of primitive, if you want to use that term. But they have a bunch of derived traits, a bunch of things that their ancestors millions of 30, 50, 100 million years ago would not have had. This duck bill is a very recently derived trait. It's very specialized. They can use that duck bill to sense the muscle firings of invertebrates that they're seeking out. So that's pretty cool to be able to electromagnetically detect your prey in the bottom of a stream. You know, our jaw is pretty similar. It sort of goes up and down, doesn't have all these electromagnetic sensors. We're sort of retaining a pretty common, simple jaw. These monotremes have 9 or 10 pairs of sex chromosomes. None of this boring, just XY thing. They have a very derived, recently evolved sex chromosome. I don't think we entirely understand how they work. And platypus have venom. I mean, how useful would that be, right? someone's asking you hard questions at the end of the seminar, you just inject them with a little venom. That would be very useful. But so those are all recently derived traits in platypus. So all extant mammals are a patchwork. Yes, there's some retained ancestral states. Yes, there's some general mammalian traits. And then you might have unique traits to your genus or even your species. So all of us are patchworks. So we're used to platypus sort of being either down at the bottom or off on the side, off on the left. So here's a tree whose focus is on primates. You know, we've got human, rhesus monkey, we've got a lemur. The focus is really on primates. We've used a non-primate placental mammal to help root it, and we've got the platypus to help root it. But in a tree focused on monotremes, sort of humans are off in this position on the side that make them sort of look older or more ancestral. So exactly who's in your tree, exactly really that the focus of the tree really determines how the tree looks to you and can really influence the misinterpretations. So how old are these lineages? They're both equally old. The best data I've been able to find suggests that common ancestor is about 170 million years ago. So since that common ancestor, mutations have been happening in both of those lineages. Natural selection has been happening in both of those lineages. Genetic drift has been happening in both of those lineages. So there's in no way the platypus lineage is older. And to me, this is where this argument was a lot harder to make in 1990 than it is in 2017. Genomic data show us that throughout, you know, mutations are occurring throughout the genome. It's not just it's not just 50 or 80 genes that influence the shape of the skeleton. You know, we have 20,000-30,000 genes that are affecting what an organism is. And so I think genomic data and the age of genomics helps us understand that both of these lineages are equally old and that our lineage has been having lots of mutation, selection, and drift that whole time. So this was a chapter I wrote in the Princeton Guide to Evolution. It was edited by Jonathan Losos. The first major section of the book was on phylogenetics. The first chapter was this chapter on tree thinking. So starting out with proper tree thinking really can help influence how you understand the entire process of evolution. So we're used to thinking of sharks as an old lineage. And one of the issues is sharks are such a species poor lineage. Sharks and rays and skates, there's only about 1,000 species. Whereas this sister group has something like 50,000 species. So that is another reason we think of sharks as being an old lineage. So there the focus is on mammals, or at least on tetrapods. But if we make the focus sharks, humans are a perfectly good outgroup for rooting sharks if you're only going to use one tetrapod or one representative of that clade. You and I share a common ancestor with great white sharks 470 million years ago. So I spend a lot of time with my son at the National Aquarium. He makes me take him every 3 months. It's awesome. And there's a beautiful display as you walk down through the spiral, and it has a bunch of silhouetted sharks. And so I was writing this paper, and that thresher shark, you know, you can easily recognize each of these species just from their silhouette. So thank you, National Aquarium. So the idea of primitive mammal or primitive species, so if you're interested in fishes, you can Google primitive fish, you'll get tons of hits. In fact, one of the top hits might be a website called primitivefishes.com. So this idea of lineages, some lineage being primitive, is absolutely pervasive. And so this is, if you do primitive mammal and Google Scholar, you get, and I remove the word fossil, so you're not talking about a species, a fossil from 50,000 years ago or 100 million years ago. We're talking about extant species. You still get hundreds of hits. While the echidna is a distinctly more primitive than eutherian mammal, so that's in Immunology 2005. The egg-laying platypus, a primitive mammal. The photoreceptor is a primitive mammal from the South American possum. So that's in Molecular Biology and Evolution, 2003. I did find some other very recent ones as well. It's not like this problem has been solved in the last 10 years. So here's a quote from U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service wrote an article in the Chesapeake Bay Journal, the Bay Journal. The opossum is North America's only native mammal or pouch mammal. So mammals are primitive. I've said, already told you, I think that word is misleading. Mammals from the time of the dinosaurs. Wow, we've got a mammal in Maryland from the time of the dinosaurs. Well, I'm going to argue that we're also from the time of the dinosaurs. So this is an equally true statement. This is, I know I'm sort of being very annoying, but I think that's part of my job today. That humans are native to Africa and are placental mammals, mammals that have a large placenta. Placentas are primitive mammals that were present during the time of the dinosaurs. So you and I share a common ancestor with the platypus or from the, and the marsupials. With marsupials, it's about 160 million years ago. So dinosaurs went extinct 65 million years ago, at least non-avian dinosaurs. So there was 100 million years of evolution of marsupials and placentals during the time of the dinosaurs. So our lineage was present during the time of the dinosaurs. The marsupial lineage was present during the time of the dinosaurs. There's nothing different about the existence of placentals versus marsupials during the time of the dinosaurs. So all of this stuff really didn't tell us anything. It sounds like a really cool thing to say about an opossum, but we really haven't been told anything. So here's this tree I showed you earlier with Homo sapiens just off to the side. You know, here's another tree focused very much on bacteria. So that's, you know, that's, this is not necessarily a more realistic representation of the tree of life. I think lots of people here would argue that, and you're probably right. But we're never going to have complete taxon sampling. It's sort of a hard question. Regardless, whenever you draw a tree, whenever an editor draws a tree, they are choosing, you are choosing what species to include. The focus of the tree really influences how it's seen. So to me, there are a couple other ways that the age of genomics have really helped us understand these issues. So when the human genome came out, and about 20,000 reading frames, Arabidopsis about 25,000, but when the rice genome came out, and there were approximately twice as many open reading frames as humans, I think that really got people's attention. How are rice have twice as many genes as we have? Rice are really simple. It's just a freaking plant with some grains at the top. Why do they need so many genes? So I think this was a really important moment to say, you know, what is complexity? So at the level of the genome, there's no obvious evidence that humans are any more complex than other organisms. Certainly if you try to compare us to other eukaryotes, for example. So the idea of saying, you know, the testing the hypothesis that humans are more or less complex than a redwood tree or than a kangaroo, it's really a non-testable hypothesis. And frankly, it doesn't help us at all. You know, whether we're trying to cure human disease or figure out, you know, a better strategy for dealing with invasive species. Knowing how complex or simple or old, not useful information. So here's another example. When evidence from the molecular clock, so when we either go sort of by whole genomes or one gene at a time, there's really no hint that any lineages have stopped evolving. At the level of the genome, certainly at the level of DNA, there's really very little hint that any lineages stop evolving. Yes, there can be slowdowns and speed-ups for various reasons, stabilizing selection, positive selection, etc. But lineages don't stop evolving. Mutation, selection, and drift all happen. So humans have a relatively similar rate of molecular evolution to other apes. So these are just a couple random cases where I found trees scaled to time. So in this particular tree, it's the Homo are a little closer to the root than some of these chimps. The gorillas in this tree seem a little closer to the root, but basically very similar rates of molecular evolution. Selection and drift are still happening. Here this shows humans as having a slightly longer branch than many of these chimps, but more or less there's no hint that there's some dramatic speed up in humans that sort of in some way represents how advanced we are and how recently we evolved and how we're such a young species, all of which is really misleading. And if you do tests for selection on coding genes, so the human lineage have fewer genes with evidence of positive selection. So I think we have this hint that, you know, that chimps and gorillas and orangutans are out there doing the same thing they've been doing for the last 3, 5, 12 million years. And we're the ones that have entered a completely new niche and have evolved all these amazing new things. But no, when you look at it one coding gene at a time, there's more evidence of positive selection in the chimp genome. So what if we focus on branch rotation? That will help us. So if we don't understand the issue of branch rotation, we will be misled. So David Bounds, a colleague at the University of Wisconsin, he's a plant molecular systematist, and he's the guy who got me to write the chapter for the Princeton Guide to Evolution. And this was 12 years ago, but this was a single page article in Science. And the whole point of the article was to just show this one figure. So certainly in 2005, the editors of Science were convinced that this was a major, major issue. And I don't think things have changed a ton since then. So if you look at this and you say, is the frog more closely related to the fish or the human? Then if you just publish, so this was the rest of the figure, we've rotated, or Baum et al. Have rotated the branches so that humans are now in the middle. Much closer to the fish. Does that change your mind? So knowing that all these branches can be rotated and the position left to right on a tree is completely arbitrary. So no matter how we rotate it, humans and mouse are always going to be next to each other on this tree. So if things are far from each other, they can't be close related. But if things are right next to each other, the frog is right next to the fish, which that could mean they're quite distantly related, or it could mean they're quite close. So if you're far away on a tree, that means something. If you're close to each other, left to right, that doesn't mean anything. So if we, the same thing applies to a gene tree. So here's a very simple gene tree of the globin gene group, and it shows that hemoglobin A and B are more closely related to each other. Those gene families are more closely related to each other than either is to myoglobin. But you might think that this implies that myoglobin is intermediate between these hemoglobins and the lampreyglobin. That's definitely something that was said in my department or was on posters in my department. But if you rotate the branch, suddenly myoglobin looks way less intermediate. So I've simply flipped it upside down. Hemoglobin B looks just the same, right side up or upside down. And we can rotate it a little more. Now we've put hemoglobin A next to myoglobin, showing that the left to right order, the order of these genes does not mean anything. So here on the right, when humans are on the right, that's just because the editors or the person who drew the figure is there. We don't change the meaning at all by rotating all the vertebrates and putting humans at the left of all of those vertebrates. So how can we think more clearly about trees? And the key thing is to use trees to think about characters one character at a time. So we can't think about platypus as primitive. We have to think about the one trait, the egg-laying trait or the venom trait, one character at a time. And so here is an example from our work. We've done a lot of work on coloration, for example, of orioles. So if our local Baltimore oriole and its western relative, a couple of different western relatives, have black on the back, but the hooded oriole has orange on the back, the fact that the orange species is sort of nested within a whole bunch of other species that all have black on the back mean that the most parsimonious ancestral state is to have black on the back. So again, we're reconstructing one character at a time. So for example, when we do this for oriole color, we've done it for 44 different patches of color. So the most parsimonious reconstruction shows one change on this branch leading to hooded orioles. So if the common ancestor of all the orioles were orange, that would require at least one or two. Or if the common ancestor back here would require at least three changes, whereas the change to orange in this lineage is the most parsimonious ancestral state. So that doesn't mean it's true. We can sequence more orioles and figure out how they fit in to further test that conclusion. But this simple principle of parsimony, we can use other algorithms as well. But the key thing is we're thinking about the characters one character at a time. So the orange species is nested within, that requires only one change. So here's a case where we have sister taxa. One group of taxa is black and one group of taxa is orange. So this is the throat coloration. So in this sort of situation, it's completely ambiguous. We could have had the common ancestor orange with one change to black, or the common ancestor with black with one change to orange. Either of those is equally parsimonious. So this root node or this root branch is equivocal or ambiguous. So when you have sisters, when groups are sister taxa, you really can't tell the ancestral state. So here's a more blatant example. This Oropendula might look to you, so this is a Central American species, gorgeous big species, they're polygamous. A single male defends a tree and 20 or 30 females put their nests in that tree. So the position of Oropendula might look like it's an ancestral position, might look like it's in an outgroup and must have the more primitive state, and that monogamy recently arose in orioles. It may look basal, so that's a problematic word. There's a lot more disagreement on that, but to me, the Oropendula might look like it's closer to the base. But if so this is the base of the tree, but it's no more close to the base than any of these other species. So I think whenever we see that word, we're very likely to be misled, thinking that this species in some way is simple, ancestral, or primitive. So again, this is the Oropendula might seem older in some way, but given the situation, the orioles are sister to the Oropendula lineage, so the ancestral state is equivocal. So this problem is rampant in published literature and textbooks. So this is a really good textbook produced by a bird molecular systematist. So this guy did his PhD on bird molecular systematics, working with some of the top people in the field. He's now has one of the most widely used textbooks, the Freeman Biological Sciences. It's the one we use at UMBC. And this this was the first edition of the book, 2002. And the argument is that this figure in the textbook shows that humans originated in Africa. Why? Because it shows the first group to branch off is from Africa. Off of what? What does it branch off of? That language, whenever you see branch off, that implies that there's a trunk. Okay, that implies a fixed reference that we do not have. So in this tree, Africans no more branched off of the rest of humanity than the rest of humanity branched off from Africans. It's a single node from which there's two descendant branches. And paying attention to those two descendant branches is crucial. So this kind of thing has happened to me over and over again. I wrote him a long two-page email. I said, your textbook is awesome, but there's this figure that's misleading, and there's several other issues. Never wrote me back. But the second edition of the text changed it. So the language of oldest branch, earliest branch, if you do Google Scholar for first branch and phylogeny, you get 3,000 plus hits. So this idea that this is in some way the first branch, this is the older branch, this is a deeper branch, is misleading and is pervasive. This branch, leads to me and a European American, where am I? You know, this branch in Northern Europe, that branch is just as long, this branch is just as early as this branch. So the next edition came out and this said not that the first branch is from Africa, but rather that the most ancestral lineages come from Africa. It shows a wide diversity of lineages from Africa, not just one branch off on the side, which is indeed reflected by the actual gene trees. So the most parsimonious ancestral state is basically that the common ancestor of all of us was in Africa, and this mitochondrial gene tree shows it's a complicated thing here, but the most parsimonious ancestral state, given that there's multiple lineages from Africa that are connected to the tree in this way that our common ancestry is from Africa. So it was a pattern of nesting, not just being off by itself on the side, that enables us to know what's the ancestral state. So if we do explicit ancestral state reconstruction, if we use algorithms rather than looking at a tree with our head and thinking that tells us something about plumage color or song or about a certain neuronal pathway, if we analyze things one character at a time. So this was I was an outside committee member. This was like just before I started really deciding that more work was needed on this. It was a pretty prominent Canadian university. The woman was studying migration distance, and she said, if I find this kind of a pattern in my tree, with a short distance migrant on the left, a medium distance migrant in the middle, a long distance migrant on the right, this shows that the way you evolve long distance migration is through medium distance. And so that was the first slide of the PhD defense, and I was just like, oh. So she is still angry to me to this day, because I made her draw this. We just switched these nodes. We haven't changed the tree at all. The meaning of the tree is the same, but suddenly the story of sort of medium distance being intermediate between short distance migration and long distance migration no longer holds up. So that knowing about that branch rotation and playing with that game with your trees can really help you understand it better. So here's a situation that would support long, short distance to medium distance to long distance migration. So this kind of, if the ancestral state back here is short distance migration, and then we evolve to medium and then to long, that only requires two changes on the tree. Or if we were to posit long distance migration was ancestral, it would require six different sort of losses of long distance migration. So we use this kind of information. If we didn't have any fossils of tetrapods, we would be able to understand the history of vertebrates and tetrapods. You know, we have something like sharks, completely going the wrong way. Something like sharks, ray fin fishes, coelacanths, and then the evolution of legs with something like frogs, mammals, reptiles, and then some subgroup of reptiles evolving wings. So that kind of pattern can clearly indicate ancestral. But using an explicit algorithm, using programs that use either parsimony or maximum likelihood or Bayesian methods to reconstruct ancestral states is absolutely key, rather than you just looking at your tree or me just looking at my tree. So to conclude the talk, what species we include in our tree, what species are in our data set, what species the textbook editor chooses to include in an illustration really affects the way the tree looks. But if we play with branch rotation, that can really help us understand what information is really in the tree. And patterns of nesting, looking for species that have state A sort of nested within a larger group that has species state B, can really help us think about which traits are ancestral, what's the ancestral state, as opposed to thinking about which lineage is ancestral or which species is ancestral. So if you do ancestral state reconstruction, one character at a time, the explicit algorithms enable us to explicitly say, here are our assumptions. So these different methods, these algorithms are not perfect, but they at least enable us to explicitly say what assumptions we're using. So I think that clear tree thinking can help us clarify the entire process of evolution. So if an intro bio student at UMBC comes in thinking that humans are the pinnacle of evolution, and they're somewhere at the top of the tree of life, but if I can get them to see that we can rotate us and to be anywhere in the tree of life, and that we and each of these other species on that tree have all been evolving for, you know, 3.5 billion years, 4 billion years, that really helps us understand the entire process of evolution in a much different way, that evolution is not goal-oriented. So just wrap up, working with Mike and Lynn for a year was awesome. Got some great funding from the Australian National University. Here's the stuff that we've written on this topic, but there's 5 or 8 or 10 other articles that sort of address the same points from different angles. But as mentioned, I have this speciation reversal project in common ravens and this conservation genetic project on Bahama orioles. So if you're interested in that sort of stuff, let me know. Thanks for your attention.